श्रीमते रामोजाय नमः। This seminar is entirely different from the other conducted seminars because of its specialized Brahman teacher as a mission. Any conference, not at all conferences actually, they are also having a mission, but unspecified, that is optional. Each and every conference should result in knowledge dissemination, knowledge acquisition, knowledge adoption, then implementation by concerned authorities. But here specifically we have mentioned that there is a mission. So that means that will be conducted at several places on several issues, several values on several angular perspective and perception will be handled till we get the solution. And even after getting the solution, for perennial flow of the solution and its sustenance as the world is ever changing. So it is a lifetime project. Mission means as long as the earth that sustains with its revolution and rotation on its axis and orbit, this should be carried, or this will be carried any name at any place by any other person. Somehow it will be ever existing as eternal as God Himself. Because I always used to say, I used to bifurcate the conferences into two things, or two major sectors. One is propositional, second is impositional. Whenever they organize very nicely, I will organize some programs which will excellently be well organized, like religious programs in which there is individual benefit, like relief from planetary tenacity, really from their illness and other mundane hurdles. For such things there will be a thronging crowd. So unless I am satisfied, organizing the same seminar with the same topic, probably at the same auditorium, is known as impositional conferences. So we are very dynamic and this energetism is unfading. But still it serves as a material. What we believe is Amo Bhadra Kartavo Yant Vishwataha. It has two meanings. Let all noble thoughts come from all sides to me. That also implies that let my noble thoughts permeate each and every corner direction of the sphere. That is the implied second meaning. So considering the second meaning, I believe that more than the listeners, that of other people, unknown people, strangers, there are silent spectators, there are other helpless people in the society, we believe that our speech, the radiance inside the speech, the veritability and depth inside the speech, will be converted into such a configurating urge which will reach all of these people and immigrate them, and one day we are going to casually, incidentally, or co-accidentally, or coincidentally going to meet them. So believing on this paranormal phenomena of phono radiation and permeation and spiritual integrity systems, we used to conduct a lot of programs without minding anything at all. First of all, I have to define what is India and what is mission. What is India's mission and what is India's actual mission? Then only I will go to the topic. What is India? India has different dimensions. The technology of India is different. The trend of India is different. The taste of India, that is different. The treasure of India is different. The tradition of India is different. Here this India's actual mission, according to me, or according to a normal prudential view, it defines only two things. One is the valuable treasure, and second is the unbreakable lineage of tradition. So treasure and the so-called tradition which carries the treasure, both of these things must be revitalized, and lack of connectivity to the lineage must be compensated by means of reconnectivity by capable tools, and to bring back the glory, to enrich, not to create a scienceless world or technology-free world. To give companionship, to give security to science and technology, we need our tradition, we need our treasure. So to comfort the whole global society, to comfort the scientific community, to go in the pathway of precision and assertivity without getting into trial and error, permutation and stages. So we are mentioning only these two things. And also the mission is of five components. First thing, to get the fullest details about our treasure, and probably the problems with the spiritualism is, we used to quote, spiritual experiences are metaphysical and scriptural messages are metaphorical. So this metaphysical experiences and metaphorical depictions that is there in scriptures and spiritualism, that has made more or less most of the common society to think it as a mystery or a myth or a deception or a non-existing entity or something which is thrusted into obsoleteness. But it is not so. Just as I used to say, I can deliver a lecture, but somebody can process it and they can give it in a palatable form. Likewise, there must be a mediator between the scriptures and common people, those who are converting the scriptural messages into palatable, delicious, sumptuous, impregnated, informative and efficacious tools for the effective functioning of the whole social mechanism. So what we lack is only a mediator between common society and these things. Thus there is a big rock and there is a weak person. We need a crane. By operating a crane, even a weak person, he can press the button of the crane. He cannot lift the stone. He can press the button of the crane and it will lift that. So we need a mediator, a lever, a pulley, a fulcrum, which we explained, we discussed in the morning. So we need such a system which will induce work efficiency and reduce risk efficiency. So that type of mediation we want to produce. So first thing is collection of materials. Second thing is orderliness of material. We have to order everything. There are voluminous treatises in Shastras. The 14 Vidyas, 64 Kalas, then interpretations in the form of Sutra Parampara, Vritti Parampara, Bhashya Parampara, Vyakhyana Parampara, Anuvakhyana Parampara, Tika Parampara, Tippani Parampara, Vivarana Parampara, Vishama Parampara, Vimarsha Parampara, Paramarsha Parampara, Tarka Parampara, Akshepa Parampara, Samadhana Parampara, Purvoksha Parampara, Siddhanta Parampara. So it is ever continuing debate and journey in spiritual knowledge and its hierarchy. So somebody must encapsulate all of these things into brevity without losing the orderliness and content's value. So first is collection, second is orderly presentation, third thing is translation. Mantras can be translated. There are three things in the Vedas. One is might of the force. Second thing is mantra or the phono-vibals or the phono-vivifying factors which deal into efficacy. Mantras are said to be predetermined or pre-arranged phonetic transmissions which without the interception or intervention of any act or manual operation directly produces the effect. So what is mantra and tantra? You think, you do and get is known as tantra. You think and get without doing, the thought process itself, it does the work. Such a hypervalent situation is called as mantra and mantric effect. So the Vedas, they have might or power by means of rituals and realization. They have mantras by contemplation and repetitive pronunciation. They have messages for understanding. Messages can be translated for following. Mantras can be translated for provoking a person's desire, but mantras are to be systematically practiced. So we have to cull out the various proportions and portions of the Vedas and we have to give a clear ideology to the public. Second thing is orderly placement of message of Veda, the might of Vedas, the mantras of Vedas with proper annotation and simplification. Then by means of translation to regional languages, it should reach how a party is catching a whole country. What was the position of the party leaders and parties before few decades? How they have done? Because they have adopted three things. They have no place barrier, they have no code barrier, they have no language barrier. At any place, in any language, any number of times, they are ready to invade like Ghazali Muhammad till they get the benefit. So that type of enthusiasm and commitment for political gain is not there for the spiritual people to get spiritual gain and society gain. Because of lack of coordination. So that is the difference. So you must be ready for any language, you must be ready for any place, you must be ready for any number of times. That type of unfading zeal is the primary medulla oblongata, it is the primary spirit for conducting the spiritual journey. It is either socialization of spiritualism or spiritualization of socialism. These things are possible only by this zeal. Azure Zeal. This is very much required. Then translation. Then the fifth thing is propagation. If you just give books, those things are insufficient. It must have dynamic people. It must have talented people. It must have people, those who are skillful in power of elocution, the power of oration and articulation, the power of permeation and penetration into the hearts of the people, minds of the people, the power of fraternity and bondage to create in the society, which creates love, dependence and loyalty, making everybody absorbable into the mechanism. Isn't it so? So these things are very much essential. This is known as mission. What is mission? Continuously doing a thing without a break, pass, diversion, dilution or dilapidation, till you get the goal, preserve the goal and sustain the goal is mission. And the mission is collection, orderly presentation, then simplification, translation and propagation. Why it is known as century? Because 2 millennia totally the degradation was mainly caused by various factors. One is invasion, second is migration, third thing is trade, fourth thing is colonization, and fifth thing is involvement of the people. There were 3 things. One is kala, second is the shastra, third thing is shruti. Shruti is contemplation of God. Shastra, they are all compound skills which are meant for supporting the Vedas, like tarka, logics, vyakarana, grammar, nirukta, etymology, prosodi, chanda, jyotisha, astronomy. All of these things are limbs. They are known as shastras. And kala is music, dance, sculpture, literature, etc. And shruti is contemplation of divine energy. Somebody asked the question, why India was invaded by lot of people? Where your gods or where your people, saints, where had they been? Then we told that totally the society was diluted, or they have been diverted to shastras and kalas, and only the least members of the society were concerned about shrutis. So shruti is a divinity, and shastra and kala, they deal with something science and art sections of the Vedas. That is a major diversion for the reason of all of these things. So we have to bring back the shruti. So more than 20 centuries, the debilitation of the spiritual vigor, the consolidation and concentration, that has been diluted by means of diversion, invasion, colonization, imperialism, inner clashes, the general bio-geo-degradation of the Kali impact. So all of these things totally they contributed for a total loss of them. So now we are having a lot of facilities. So according to Shastras of cause and effect, the Karma Karana Bandha, for 2000 years, for 20 centuries of degradation, certainly it would have taken more than 4 or 5 centuries. But now Kali is also a blessing in disguise, that we are having lot of various methodologies of propaganda, like electronic media, print media, simplification, lot of other supporting tools are there. Moreover, the people are already in distress, disappointment and depression. So it is very easy for us to go in the track utilizing the electronic and print media and to get the proper way of propaganda, like military propaganda, like intelligence propaganda, knowing about the mentality. So we must milk the cow which is submissive to dance and which is submissive to song. And that is a saying, there is a proverb in Tamil. So that which is prone to song and that which is subservient to dance, those things are to be milked on their own way. So understanding psychology, understanding sociology is very much essential for propagation. So theosophy, sociology and psychology are like 3 eyes of a propagator. And even though theology or philosophy is not there, as the other 2 things are there with the Christian missionaries, they have succeeded. They know sociology, they know psychology. What is the trend of the society? What is the proclivity of this individual? So they used to handle it very perfectly, and it is not their personal intellectual property, right? Anybody can handle that. With the help of theosophy, philosophy, epistemology, etymology, entology, ontology, teleology, agatology, erismatology, then tomatology, aritology, eschatology, ontology, cosmology, cosmopolitan, innumerable sciences are there with more values hidden in our shastras. With the benefit of immaculate, that is ever showering wisdom, inexhaustible wisdom, we can handle also psychological instincts and sociological factors to get into proper value of propagation. That is the century mission. So these 20 centuries of degradation, it will take at least 5 generations to get into a proper cure or perfect cleanliness. this perfect, absolute, consummate cleanliness will happen after only 5 generations. So it is known as century mission. So we have defined what is India, what is mission, India's mission and India's century mission. Now God has created everything. He has manifested everything from His belly, and according to Shastras, He sucks everything at the time of cosmic dissolution. So whenever He spits it, it is known as creation. But at the time of creation, He makes only a preliminary creation. He does not give any form or structure or composition. He creates all the ingredients and He has gifted us discretion, the power to desire and to use. So discretion starts with determination. Determination ends in curiosity. Curiosity gives you creativity. Creativity blossoms into innovative temper results in formation of various things. So this is how God has created a balanced way of a species and space. The space being unprocessed and species, especially the advanced species of human being, given the courage, given the capability, given the competence by His discretion, by His discrimination, by His determination, how to process these raw ingredients and to give you full form. So this is known as formation. The first manifestation is known as creation. Then the human being, he undertakes the second grade of creation, which is formation. In the course of formation, due to degradation of the principles of ethicism and morality, it will be subjected to deformation by means of negligence or ignorance or arrogance. This deformation occurs at the time of which great stalwarts, great personalities rise to put it in the own form, repatriate to the own form, that is known as reformation. So creation, formation, deformation and reformation. These are all the various stages of journey in the processing the world and its actions. Likewise, we are now going to deal with reforms. So reforms means already that which has been formed for the welfare of the society at large, which has been deformed by negligence, ignorance and arrogance, misappropriation of people, that like-minded personalities, committed personalities, personalities who are the embodiment of sensitivity, loyalty and sacrifice, those people, now we are going to make a conceptualization, visualization and implementation of those tenets to reform the society which is deformed. So if it is deformed, why it is deformed? Because there are some beneficiaries for deformations. From deformation, lot of people are getting the benefits. If you are subjected to disease, you may be feeling uneasy, but that is the easiest and luxurious position for those microbes or germs that are causing the disease. It may be dis-ease for you, but it is the position of luxury for the germs inside. Likewise, those who are the parasites of the formation and precision of the society, those people, they will enjoy a lot of benefits and they will be very potential. You have to just counter them and get back the position into reformation or the originality. Now there are four major things, innumerable things are there to state. There are only four major things: education, economy, administration and electoral reforms. Everything starts with education. All our process should start with education. For knowledge inculcation, you must start with education. For implementation, it must end with political reforms, because administration system is having the power and education system is having the capability to instill. So everything, any reform system should start with education and end with power. If it does not start with education, it cannot blossom. If it does not end with power, it won't be beneficial to the society. It will be futile. So for instillation, education is the beginning point, and the surrendering point, the ultimate point is politics for fructification. Instillation and fructification. Number one, education is the beginning point, I have already told. And education consists of four steps, I want to say. And the absence of any step that will result the education to be called as partial blindness. One is the spirit to learn. Second is the subject to learn. Third is the support to learn. And fourth is success for your learning. So you must start with the spirit, then expand towards the subject, then blossom with a support. Then it will end, it must culminate in a success. And four things are essential, and spirit is the basic thing. This spirit can be induced from anything, from your mother, from your father, from your master, from your risk, from your challenges, from your hardships, from your suppressions. Anything may produce, anything may induce your spirit. For lot of people, they have learned that from their depressions. Lot of people become vehement and potential by their failures. So depending upon the people's natural proclivity, they may learn from anything. There are lot of people who have not learned from masters but learned well from fate. So innumerable teachers are there, innumerable inducers are there. So what is the spirit? What is the motivation of spirit? Motivation of the spirit in education, it induces the person to know, to do and to achieve. That is motivation of spirit. To know, to do and achieve. What is achievement? Achievement is not only success. It is the capability of continuing your effort even in the case of failure. That is known as achievement. That type of achievement that requires courage. And achievement-oriented things based on just triumphant values, they are useless. More than that, in spite of defeat, incessant charge and diminishing charge of a person's vigor and commitment to reach in spite of the failure is known as achievement. So, we want to clearly define that education is not a process to make you study, make you know. It is not a process to make you to do. It is not a process to struggle with you to get into achievement. It is not a process to make you know or to make you do or to struggle and support and suffocate with you for your achievement. But it is a process of motivation of your already existing spirit. Then there are three systems of education. One is motivation of spirit. Second thing is induction of awareness. Third thing is response. Whatever we are teaching in the school, now it is only a response for their instruction. So, teachers can induce response, preachers can induce awareness, preceptors can only induce motivation of spirits. Like Ramanuja, Madhvacharya, only Acharya, they can induce motivation of spirit. And the preachers, those who are having some commitment and values, without any spiritual zeal or special prowess, they can induce your awareness. Other people, they can induce only your response. Have you understood? Yes, I have understood. This is what instruction response. That is the inferior education. Mediocre education is awareness. Superior education is motivation of spirit, which is fortunately or unfortunately not available anywhere except in stories. So this is real education. Then there comes a question. If this education is to be imparted, we need four things. Where is the ideal institution? Where are the ideals? Who is the ideal master and where are the ideal students? There must be a question for that. If you want any product, either you must have an online trading or you can import from any other foreign country, you can purchase by order or you can just ask somebody to create that. There will be some possibility for purchase of any community. Likewise, these ideals, where they are purchasable? The answer is ideals, ideal institutions, ideal students and ideal masters. Among these four things, only an ideal master, he can create everything. Ideal master, if he is available, he can create ideals, he can create ideal institutions. He can idealize the students whether they are ideal or not. So an ideal master is very much required for this time. And this ideal master, what he will do? He will guide you with morality. Morality is, there are, somebody asked me, there are so many people who are honest, but they are suffering. They are being threatened. Then that is honest. Morality is potential. Morality is not only having honesty, but also a potential fortification of your honesty so that all other evil forces are bombarded when they cross or touch you. What is morality? Morality is not lack of opportunity to do wrong things. It is not also physical incapability or opportunistic incapability or environmental incapability to do wrong things. But it is the mental incapability, having not the mind to do things in spite of opportunities, in spite of our benefits or in spite of our various other coercive forces, environmental conditions. So that is known as morality. So two explanations for morality. Morality is having inbuilt potential. Second thing, it is just the mental refusal or it is a power of a mental incapability where the mind does not cooperate in spite of the benefit, favor, development and various other things that are there. By doing that and by not doing, there may be a threat, there may be a torture, there may be a tension, there may be a turmoil, whatever it may be. That type of capability of having the fullest potential restraint in dharma, in the principles, against the various other malicious instincts, that is known as morality. These people, they are capable of doing three things. One is morality instillation, morality courage and morality determination. These three things must be done at the impressionable age. If you just teach Aesop fables and various other Panchatantra stories, that is morality instillation. That will not be transformed into courage, and that will not become determination. What is determination? Till the person dies, that morality gives him four comforts. One is comfort to behave with morality, comfort to correct other persons to morality, third is protest against immorality, and triumph against immorality. All of these three things are, the four things are there, very much essential with the determination of morality. Determination and courage can be instilled only by a spiritual transmission or by a divine intervention, not by telling stories. Those things are instillation. So for making all of these things, we want three forces. One is the inner force, second is the outer force, third is the innermost force. The innermost force is known as anugraha, the inner force is known as achara, the outer force is known as acharya. These three forces are very much essential, and this triad is going to mold you. It is going to structuralize you in the pathway of not only morality instillation by stories, by experiences and depictions and narrations, but also gives you the courage by which you follow, and also the determination by which you flourish and immorality perish. That is the greatness of this spiritual way of wisdom. And we have to create an institution. Everybody is saying that we have to do. We must immediately create an institution with these methodologies. Otherwise, immediately we are going to be victimized by professional rascaldom of the society, the functional disability and abnormality of the society. There are only two options. If you are not participating in this program, either you will be victimized or you are going to leave your son or daughter as a victim for these abnormalities. Because till they have been assassinated or till they have been bombarded, do the people, those who have been bombarded in bomb explosions, or the people assassinated by terrorists, do they know about terrorism or counter-terrorism? When they actively participating in such programs, the commonalities or the civilian people, those who are accidentally subjected to, victimized by these bomb explosions and other terrorist disruptive activities, did they pay proper attention in learning all of these things? Could they have at least imagined that they would be subjected to such circumstances? Because we must understand that anything may happen to any person on any time. So knowing that it is a global danger and you are a part and parcel of global, and anything may happen to you or to your dependents or your beloved beings, you must take an initiative to establish an institution with two students or three students, or you yourself sit before the mirror, teach or learn or do something. So it must be done. We are there to cooperate, and somebody must give hands for institutionalization of these concepts. Then next we are coming to economy. Economy is a study of resources. It starts with the monetary scale, fiscal scale, financial scale, then policy scale, then eco-resource scale, depending upon the person to whom it refers, starting from micro-level economics to macroeconomics. So this is known as ecology. There are three economic resources as per the Shastras. The primary sources are known as Bhaumika. Second sources are known as Prakritika. Third things are known as Bhaudhika. These things are there in Shastras. And there are different types of interpretations for this thing also. So the first resource is water, earth, minerals, fire and various other natural components. The second thing is physical, mental, collective, intellectual, instrumental, scientific and technological. All of these resources. The third thing is global resources, by which mutual resources between nations, transnational resources, federal resources, and global resources. So there are three types of understanding the resources, and each and every country must have resources evaluation or assessment and management. How it is managed? By two methodologies. What is our country's nature? How much we can produce on which base? Second thing, what is the composite structure of the manpower? How we can bring these people? So what is the availability and what is the possibility in development? Third thing is, apart from our indigenous sources of manpower and resources, what are the things that we can do by a global venture, by a mutual beneficial scheme or supportive scheme from other nations? How we can contact the other nations and develop a productive relation for developing all of these things? These three things are very much essential in evaluation of resources. What do we have? How much do we have? What do we have is natural resources. How much do we have is manpower resources. Then what are the things that are adaptable from sources, and what are they and how they are to be adapted? So according to Shastras also, the classification of the society is very much different. Number one, society has three people are three modes of people. One is the burdens of the society. Second is the blunders of the society. Third type of people are the boons of the society. The burdens of the society, they are of two types. One is small children, helpless people. They are the burdens of the society. Irresponsible members, physically handicapped or decapacitated people, mentally retarded people, they are also forming the burdens of the society. Then the blunders of the society is drug addicts, alcoholics, then those who are engaged in the holy act of immoral trafficking, smuggling and other things, and those who are engaged in disruptivism, rowdyism, terrorism, fundamentalism, etc. They are all the blunders of the society. Then those who are trainable, those who are tameable, those who are talented, those who are gifted, those who are proficient and prodigious, they are the boons of the society. So we have to take care of the boons of the society, pull out the resources, cull out the resources and integrate so as we can support the decapacitated members of the society and we can reform the blunders of the society. There are three possibilities for reformation of these blunders. One is isolation, they must be isolated by imprisonment. Second is rehabilitation and socialization if possible. Third thing is amputation, social surgery. So according to Shastra, they say lot of such things. So we must understand that even on contrary environments, the rowdies, they are very talented than the police. The terrorists, they are very talented than the military. But everything is talent misplaced. Once in a seminar of terrorism, I told that terrorism is absolute patriotism misplaced. What are the qualities of patriots? Everything will be very perfectly found in a terrorist, not in a patriot. I told in one seminar. Why patriots, they are not succeeding? And why these terrorists, they are succeeding? Because terrorists, they are very much confined, connected, and they care only about the work. They won't think about anything else. But patriots feel something and they just take leave. The second thing is, why do patriots meet? There may be a clash of you or me. Whenever terrorists meet, they don't think about you and me. What we have to do? Back to bombard, back to explode. So that will be the mission of those people. So that is patriotism misplaced, I used to say. So economy can develop only by proper evaluation and proper value of flexibility of economy and adaptation of a multi-level economy. That must be there. It is possible only by a good administration. Because I have already told you, if you want to bring mass benefit, as an individual, I can bring 10 people. I can bring 100 people, I can connect to 2 places because my resources are limited. If it is imperial resources, institutional, individual and imperial resources. If it is imperial resources, if I were the Minister for Science and Technology, for Social Welfare or for Religion and Development, then immediately with the full domination and sovereignty, we can implant all of these things at various places because we have resources. We have mind, we have manpower, everything is there. So everybody must aim at a ruling system. Either they have to rule, or their coordinate members, or their like-minded spirits, or the favorable spirits for the development of the nation, they must come for rule. So that is why administration. Administration means only legislation. And the judicial and the other things are there, the bureaucratic things are there. They are very submissive. They exist by subservience and negligence. So those people, they cannot be brought into the scene at all. I have already told in one ethical, this moral fabric seminar, I told one phenomena which was very much appreciated and applauded by people. Triple M phenomena. What is triple M phenomena? Mutation for mutual mistakes. I have done a mistake. Don't cross me. Likewise, you can do any mistakes or you have also done mistakes, I won't mind that. It is mutation for mutual mistakes. So this is the major rule. It is the India Century Mission, mutation of mutual mistakes, that is running the political machine now. Everybody, they have done a mistake, or they are going to do a mistake. Either they will be rupee sinners or past sinners. Past sinners, their records will be just explored and they will be put into trial. Future people, they will be captivated red-handed. So they want to avoid all of these things. Mutation for mutual mistakes. Observe silence, both sides. Maunam kalakanam kalahanasti. So this thing is prevailing in this administration. So legislation is the primary thing. And there are 5 responsibilities. Lot of people told, why you are talking about politics? We don't want politics. Even if you don't want politics, you are having a basic responsibility of politics. There are 5 responsibilities of politics. One is elective responsibility. Second thing is supportive responsibility. Third thing is active responsibility. fourth thing is administrative responsibility, fifth thing is dominant responsibility. So even though we are not dominant, even though we are not in administration, even though we are not active in politics, even though we need not even support some people, we must have the elective responsibility. And that was the question asked by a lot of people to me. Yes, how it is possible? We are like Magnificent Seven, single man army, and we are limited and our resources are limited. And these people, the dirt is dense. The political dirt is dense. How we can remove the dense dirt? With a lot of other abnormal practices. What are the practices of politics? Totally those things are very stupid. Stupendously stupid. And comfortably dangerous to the growing generations. How are you going to get rid of them? Number one, power share. Number two, wealth share. Third thing is dynasty breeding. Fourth thing is favor and favor executions. Fifth thing is image building. Sixth thing is suppression of facts. Existing politics, I am saying, suppression of facts. Seventh thing is muscle rule. Eighth thing is trade. These are the Ashtanga yogas of modern politics. So persons may ask, how we are going to do that? We are limited people, we are non-violent people, we are spiritual people, we are pious, we are virtuous, we are soft. These soft, tender people, delicate-minded people, how we are going to face these demonic and fiendish imps? The Shastra says that you must not totally be negligent of society. Non-participation in politics is a social crime, and you are sharing the sin of all the things, all the activities and its impacts which the ruling party is doing. If you are not selecting anybody, if you don't exhaust your right or responsibility for election, immediately you will get a social crime, but also there is a sin share. Any person coming to rule, you will join with the sin. Then how we can execute? There are three possibilities. One is a silent protest. You just, there will be a lot of independent candidates. By putting your vote, they are not going to come into rule. Meanwhile, you can also exhaust or you can implement your voting right also. If you can select a good person, okay. But you have to vote for somebody. Otherwise, there will be having some representative imposter who will go there and put bigger vote. Isn't it so? So we must not neglect this thing at all. Because unless we have power, all of our policies are like the betel nuts in a teethless mouth. It won't have any value. Certainly we must have some power. Powerless persons cannot do anything. They can just dream, imagine and depart. So, this protest, silent protest is not encouraging that person. Encourage any good person or do something casually to some person accidentally which is not going to contribute to something conspicuous. The second thing is mass protest. You have to organize a mass protest. Gradually you have to organize that. Then the third thing is known as judicial protest, wherever there is visible or transparent mismanagement, corruption or any other thing, you can protest like that. It is just like a jar of water, we used to say in Shastras. There is a jar of water, full of dirty water, wastage. You keep on pouring water inside. It is full of water, keep on just pouring inside. It will be diluted, 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 diluted. At one stage, you will be seeing only good water inside. Likewise, we have to penetrate into the dirt system with a catalytic skill of not being mingled or not being metamorphosed by their relation and connectivity, still capable of at least having some influence on them. So this is a very slow process. We cannot create wonders between dawn and dusk. It takes its own time. That's why we have named it a century mission. Nobody can ask why we have not done it. We will say a century mission. We are doing it, this is the process. Yes. We have to do these three protests: judicial protest, mass protest, and silent protest. Basic thing, what is the problem with politics? Only corruption. Everywhere there is corruption. Everybody is getting into some problem, or everybody is putting others into problem only because of their avarice. So that is corruption. Corruption, everybody says that getting money is corruption. Not only getting money is corruption. Corruption is defined in Shastras in a deeper sense. Corruption basically it is favoring a person by anything for reward snatching and risk avoidance. For getting a benefit, it may be a revenge, it may be a reward, it may be revenue. And also to avoid some risk. So risk avoidance, reward, revenue and revenge. The third thing, whenever you favor somebody, promote somebody, on the feelings of any bondage between caste, religion, or language, etc. That is also corruption. And reasonless prejudice for a capable, competent, deserving person, that is also corruption. Unlawful obedience for your superior officers, that is also corruption. If you want recognition and reputation in society, you do some unlawful encroachment, that is also corruption. So corruption is multifold. It is not only bribery, embracery, or getting money. So corruption is multifold. These things can be very effectively done only when good people jump. That is why Plato told, these type of dirty politics, they are developed not by the careful nourishment of the dirty elements, but the negligence of the clean elements of the society. They are developing only by us, only by our negligence. The development for them is only just by the manner of our negligence and non-participation. We have to do, and we have to dismantle the four pillars of modern politics. What are the four pillars of modern politics? Bribery, murder, forgery, and fraudulence. Without these four things, political game and gambling, they cannot be conducted, and certainly a dawn must come and God must throw light upon divine persons so that divine persons should rule. It may not be even theocracy, persons who obey divine orders, persons who believe in divinity, persons who are practical benevolence of divine shower, persons who are worshippers of God, are divinity personified, irrespective of the status of being either a saint or a sage or even a scholarly person, or a benevolent dictator like Rama Parikshita used to say, they are benevolent dictators. Such a person either God, godly, God made, God sent person, they must come for rule. Then only we can create the benefits. Then finally coming to electoral reforms. Why we are calling electoral reforms? Because our country is ruled by democracy. So democracy has the electoral methodology, so we have to create electoral reforms. Nature and selectivity. Nature and selectivity. For example, if you keep a ruby and a worm, or a ruby and a dead rat before a crow, which will it select? There is a dead rat and there is a diamond. Both start with D, let us keep. A crow is asked to select something which is very valuable. Which one is select? Only the dead rat or dead body. Because it cannot evaluate that ruby or diamond. Likewise, nativity, nature and selectivity. These things are interconnected. If you ask fools to form a group and select some person, then immediately they will select a high-end fool or a person who can fool them in turn. If rogues are elected, are given the opportunity to elect somebody, they will bring some high-end rogue. So this is the nature. For example, I want to say something. Just as there must be a rule or a regulation or a principle of eligibility for the person elected, so it is known as, in surgery, can you select a doctor by appearance or by your relation? We can select the people for each and everything, even to stitch your clothes, you search for a good tailor. For each and everything, you take good clothes, good food, you want everything good with good brand. Then in selection, why you are in negligence, why you are very much poor and underrated? You must select only good people. Can you select somebody, your neighbor as he is a close friend for 30 years, can you give the surgical weapon for operation without going to a capable doctor? So it is also a social surgery, national surgery, in which the unwanted elements are evil elements or degradable elements of the society, they are totally put apart by excision, and the social structure and salubrity is maintained by a vigilant movement. So it is also a type of seriousness and sincerity. And it must not be just given for option or for some other useless things. So it must be properly selected, they must be taught how to select, or their selection right must be confiscated. So these two things are, the second thing cannot happen in the constitutional position of modern India. But still, if the selectivity either, we have to teach them the democratic right and value. The second thing, at least if they are not properly behaving, their right must be totally confiscated. If that thing is not possible, do this. There are two commissions. We know only about the election commission. Second is the public commission. The commission of the public, the integral federal public, and that decides. They decide lot of things. The election commission can do lot of things. I have already told about image building, suppression, lot of other things are there. They can get into those areas. Like don't advertise much and don't bribe people. So conspicuously don't do that in our presence or as those things are coming to our notice. So without our notice or knowledge, anything may be practiced. So, electoral reforms are very limited. It is disqualification of a party or a person for his malpractices or for prosecution, and limitation of the norms for conducting elections in which a just way of the election rights of the people can be executed. Is the election commission doing anything for creating vigilance about the sense of electivity in the public? Is that included in the election commission's norms? It is not there. So that is why it is blind, it is unilateral, it is useless, it is fit for nothing itself. Why you are restricting those people? You restrict these people. There are only few hundreds. There are lakhs of crores of people, those who are going to determine. And who is there to control the person's vehemence or disordered projection? Or who is there to tune knowledge and awareness? And who is the person to relieve them from stupidity, swan stupidity, voluntary stupidity, committed idiocy? Who is there to rectify all of these people? Only public commission, NGOs and good standards from the society, they have to do these things. The society is totally disorganized and scattered by means of language favor, community or caste favor, religious favor, some craze, political leaders or senior actors, some craze. The fifth thing is benefit loyalty. He will give me some post, he will give me some benefit, some power share, some wealth share, something I have already told you. So this is communal favor. Second thing is religious favor. Third thing is removal favor. Fourth thing is craze. Fifth thing is benefit loyalty. So all of these things have made the society to be scattered, so that they need not be united again to have a vigilant look who is going to be elected and who is going to be controlled. So it is, they are carefully maintaining the society in such a manner that they will not be integrated at any cost, at any time again. So this is the society. So we have to create two things. One is for the budding youth and for the already blossomed youth generations who are having the voting rights, we have to teach them democratic awareness and democratic training. Second thing is very wonderful and even humorous. It is vote value. Each and every is casting a vote. Vote has a value. They must be created a vigilance about vote value. That is vote value vigilance program, triple V program, in which we have to say two things as per Darwin language. One is disproportionate benefit. Second is last burden. We have to say that MLA, he has given you 500 rupees or 1000 rupees, but the wealth that he has gained is 50 lakhs or 50 crores. Second thing is last burden. Whatever the black money that is circulated by these people in the society that will enable and empower them to purchase lot of properties, and without proper supply, the demand will be more, the prices will shoot up. Then immediately there will be crisis, hike up in prices, it will create inflation in the society. So that last burden will be in the form of either taxation or interest rate being leveled high in banks, which will come only to the fate of the skull of the person, the subject. So the last is burden on you, and you are getting only 500, he is getting 50 lakhs. Improportionate benefit and last burden, by which the persons must be tuned or tutored to ask for higher demands or greater demands. What is higher demand? Higher demand is, I am not ready to vote you for 500 rupees, give me 5 lakhs. So, 1000 people within a village, they must take a determination that unless you give 5 lakhs, we won't vote. We will select somebody else. That is higher demand. Greater demand is, you put road, bring electricity, do all these things. So, this must of vigilance and courage must be brought in the public. It is known as triple V, vote value vigilance. Then ending with India once more, India has given, lot of people, they have given lot of things, inventions we have seen, lot of westerners. What is the use? The basic qualities for life, three things are given only from India. The knowledge of India, the experience of India, the estimation of India, the realization of the Indian sources. So the first thing is misapprehension, suspicion, oblivion and deception. And it facilitates universal distribution, and it facilitates also proper distribution, deeper distribution and effective distribution. That is known as jnana. Second thing is tyaga, sacrifice, in which we gain by losing things, and by seeing people gaining lot of things, but even though we lose, we gain by our loss. So that type of eudaimonic experience, which we gain by losing things for the benefit of others, is sacrifice. That mentality we can develop only in India, and Indian knowledge source is the only vital source available for that. Third thing is yoga, to feel oneness with God, with creations, with the creatures. Whole universal brotherhood and communal brotherhood, global family, global village, universal brotherhood, oneness with God, everything is there, yoga, that is there in our greatest language of our philosophical tongue. But there are some problems. The second thing is, even though these values are available, they are crude and unprocessed. We cannot handle it. They are crude and unprocessed. Then the next step is, you know that there are a lot of cool drinks like Rasna and other things. There are a lot of energy drinks. They know that they must have mentioned the label itself. Mix it with cool water or hot water or with milk or any other cool drinks or any other beverages. It must be given there. In all the things, labelation, they must have given that. With any beverage, hot or cold, it must be there. Likewise, we must process this knowledge and give it, mix it in three forms. One is education. Second is entertainment. Third is exercise. So somebody must give spiritual education. It must be either a silent mixture in the already existing syllabus or as a supportive syllabus. The second thing is entertainment, spiritual entertainment. I used to call it as spritainment. Like educational entertainment, they have framed it as edutainment. So it is spritainment. Then the third thing is by exercise. So whatever the exercise that you do, whatever the entertainment you prefer, and whatever the education you are channelized with, so it must be a processed way of the spiritual values of jnana, tyaga and yoga. That must be done. And there is a problem. Why Westerners are succeeding and these Indian people, they are not succeeding? Certainly, there must be a minus point for our failure and there must be a plus point with them for their success. We cannot deny everything like that blindly. Even though we are having invisible sources like Vaivasvata, Swayambhuva, Atri Vishnu Harita Yagyavalgya Aushana Paiti Nasi Angira Yama Apastamba Vaishambayana Ranayaniya Paila Sumandu Jaimani Katyayana Vivaspati Varasara Vashita Shakti Shanka Likita Pulastya Kanva Taksha. Innumerable religions are there and we are having lineages with them. But there is no connectivity allowed. So for all invisible people, the binding force, the physical force which creates effect is connectivity. For all the existing visible forces, integrity. The Westerners, they are having phenomenal integrity. They are having composite integrity in success. Out of either curiosity, out of either fancy, out of either craze, whatever it may be, they are well binded. They will see whether that is true or not. And they are very much vehement in their experimentation, analysis and hypothesis. They are ready to spend their time, they are ready to spend their effort and economy for it. So, in spite of having invisible sources in abundance, we have no connectivity. In spite of having mortal limited visible sources, they have integrity. Now we have to create a binding spirit, either in the form of a power, or in the form of a person, or in the form of a group of persons who should renew the license of our relative connection and linkage with the invisible, uncountable supporting factors, by means of which we can once again assume the global leadership and we can lead the whole world, not with any independence or with the idea of getting into the process of enslaving the society. It is embracing the society and enslaving the society. We Indian people are not like that. Let me hope that things will be initiated very soon and so many things in depth will be discussed in the forthcoming sessions. Narayana.
Yes, energizes, mesmerizes, elevated us, ennobled us, empowered us to such a high level. Please hold on, you should not fly. All movements in the world for the last 10,000 years have started small. Whether it's a spiritual movement of Sai Baba or Amritananda, or a Marxist movement, communist movement of Mao Zedong started three people, Edgar Snow, Jack Weldon and Mao Zedong. All great movements, Shankaracharya's movement if you like, everything started small. So first thing which I want to say to all of you after listening to Swamiji, who mesmerized us to elevate, give us more energy coming from unknown sources, is to say that though it may take 100 years, we have to be happy with what we can do. A lady teacher went to Wagga Wagga border and whenever with the children she was teaching, primary school children, and the moment the English Indian flag went up, she made the children sing, Jenda Uncha, Rehe Hamara Bada. Every month she was doing it. And therefore a commandant said, Madam, why are you doing this? Why are you doing this? So she said, that's all what I can do for my country. Every month I come with a 1,000 rupees salary which I have, spend 100 rupees to bring the children here, hoping that one of these 40 children whom I bring every month will produce one person who will rescue this country from public humiliation, harassment, humbling and defrauding and so on. Therefore, whatever we do is more than adequate. I must also say that Buddha was the first man to say, don't kill an animal. He was the first man to say before Mahavira. Yet all Buddhists are non-degrees. And they made a clever way, as Swamiji was saying. One bhikshu was sitting and saying, Buddha Mujaranam Gacchami. One crow was there. Crow was like, one neat piece came down from his mouth. He came here. He took it to Buddha. Oh Lord, can I eat it? He said, are you hungry, fellow? Yes. Can you eat it? I can try. Did you kill it? No. Go ahead. That is how Buddhists became non-degrees. By clever fraud, which they did that. Therefore, point number one, that this movement started with Swamiji. He's a chief patron. I want you to know that. It's not written there. Swamiji is the chief patron of the India Century Movement. As far as I'm concerned, everywhere I meet Ambani, he has promised help. This morning I spent 3 hours with the